All right, I want to talk about something that most of you have heard about here and there as you've read about or learned about or watched disc golf. There's this thing that people have talked about called the rubber band effect. What is the rubber band effect? I heard it too for years. I heard it discussed in a very cryptic, strange way by the guys who could really, really bomb in the sport. Guys like Eagle McMahon and specifically Simon Lazard has talked about the rubber band effect. This feeling that he would get in his body that he was trying to describe to other people that you could definitely observe in Simon's form and in the form of other people that produce this same rubber bandy effect. But if you're throwing the way that probably 99.9% of people throw, where you're using your right arm to initiate acceleration in the disc, or if you're lefty, obviously it's your left arm, but your dominant throwing arm, you never feel the rubber band effect at all. It's totally mystical. It doesn't even make any sense. When people talk about the rubber band effect, they might as well be describing, I don't know, what it would feel like to gyroscopically balance yourself on a bicycle seat when you've never ridden a bike before. You don't even know what they're describing. I know what the rubber band effect actually feels like now after spending 20 years chasing the dragon. It's a very, very interesting feeling of elasticity. And the one kind of analogy that I can make about what the rubber band effect actually is, for the most part, is it's going to relate to a story from my childhood. When I was a little guy, probably about 7, 8, 9 years old, I spent a lot of time outdoors in Palo Alto, California. And I was down in the creeks and in my neighbor's backyards and running around on the street. We didn't have really gaming back then. So you spent all of your time either playing outdoors or you spent a lot of time reading. And I did kind of a mixture of both, depending on whether or not the sun was out. And as a little kid, I would prowl around in the creek and stuff by my house, which is this deep, like 30-foot chasm, actually, much more like a canyon than a creek. And I was always on the lookout for a specific type of tree branch that I could use to make a bow and arrow. And I wouldn't cut down any of the trees, but I'd find, you know, discarded wood, and I'd find pieces of broken wood all the time because of the violence of the water going through the creek. And I was always on the hunt for the perfect wood to make a bow and arrow out of. And every now and then I'd find one. I think in my childhood I maybe found 4 or 5. And every time I found one, I would make a bow out of it by whittling it with my knife that I had and creating a nice, decently curved shape. And then I would affix a bowstring to it. I think I used, might have used fishing line actually. I think I used fishing line. It was kind of the best thing. Although maybe it was too elastic. But either way, I'd find a good bowstring and then I would make my own arrows by buying dowels from the hardware store that were like about that long, and I would whittle down the point and then sharpen them perfectly into a cone on the sidewalk, and then I would fletch the back of the arrow with masking tape. I'd make like a perfect little triangular rocket fin at the back of it and then fletch it and trim it and stuff. And masking tape was very, very good, easier to use than feathers, it turns out. And I'd notch it, and I had my bow and arrow, and I would go to this field by my house that I'd have to go there at dusk because you can't be shooting a bow and arrow in a public field during the daytime when kids and dogs and stuff are running around. So I would go out there with my bow and arrow and it could shoot probably 100 yards. But what I noticed through trial and error was that I would pull the bow back and I'd kind of get the angle just right. And right before I'd release it, I would yank the bow a little bit more. I would jerk the bow string, maybe an extra 3 to 4 inches, whatever the draw of the bow would allow in my own strength. And it would just make the arrow go so much farther. It was crazy how much extra energy it produced it. And you'd never really see a normal archer do that. If you watch those guys, I'm gonna imagine I have a bow in my hand. If you watch those guys, those North Korean guys, or not North Korean, sorry, South Korean guys. Do North Koreas, do they have an archery team? They probably do. South Korean guys, and they're amazing marksmen, right? They're like insanely accurate. They can shoot bullseyes from, I don't know, 70, 80 yards away. It's insane. They don't do that with the bowstring. They pull it back and they use the tension that they put into the pulley system. And the bows basically, they're kind of like cheating, let's get real. They have like a scope on them. Either way, they have to get the trajectory right and they hold it and they hold it and then they just let the arrow go as smooth as can be and the bow just goes whoop and droops out of their hand. That's how modern archers shoot, to shoot accurately. But if you were on the battlement of some castle like 1,000 years ago and the cavalry's coming for your women and children. You wanna kill them all, right? How are you gonna shoot arrows? You're gonna hit those fuckers as far away as possible, which means you need extra power out of your longbow. And you would draw this big ass bow back, but at a certain point, you can't hold it. And you don't want everybody firing like in a desultory manner. You need to fire in waves. One, two, three, loose, right? Except that you pull the bow back, and right before you let it go, you yank on the string, for sure, to give the arrow extra energy. I did that as a kid, figured it out too, and that's what the rubber band effect is. That's what it is, actually, because what we're really trafficking in when you throw hard in this sport is inertial mass, that thing I keep talking about. When things move, energy is vibration of matter. It's energy. It's energetic. That vibration increases the energy of the system, and that energy shows up as extra inertial mass. It's more energy is required to displace that inertial mass. The more it vibrates and spins, the faster it goes, the heavier it becomes. If you think about Loop Ghost and his videos that he's been putting out for years and years, I used to watch this as a younger man. They've been around forever. In Loop Ghost's videos, he talks about the heavy disc. And I don't know how fast Loop Ghost throws, but the harder you throw, the heavier that object is going to be. And it creates this kind of cascade of biomechanical feedback in your brain, which I'll get to in a little bit. I'm going to cut to a second video where I talk about it at length so I don't screw up here and have to re-record it. So back in a second.